an original Erie Otter joining us on the OHL podcast this week. But not only that, before he was an Otter, he was with one of my favorite all-time OHL teams in Niagara Falls, a draft pick by one of my favorite NHL teams in Hartford. So much to talk about with Steve Nimmagon. A real pleasure, sir. Thanks for making the time.
No, I'm real happy to be here, and it looks like I've checked a couple boxes for you, so that should help out a little bit and talk about a few things.
Yeah, you certainly have checked those boxes. And you also, I want to make this clear on the record. I told you this when we first connected. This is a guest by request on the OHL podcast. One of our fans, Tyler's his name, great guy, huge fan of the OHL, says, you got to get the first captain of the Erie Otters on the podcast. So here we are with the first captain of the Erie Otters. There you go.
Awesome. Fantastic. Once upon a time ago, I always said it would end up as a trivia question somewhere down the road. So here we are. And it's funny to look back on that. But yeah, that's where we were.
Why don't we start with that piece? Because it's an honor to get the C on your jersey, no matter which team you're playing for. You had it in Niagara Falls the year prior, but as a first-year franchise, being the on-ice leader, and from what we've learned off-ice too, and we can talk about that, but what does that mean to you, especially looking back?
It was, at the time, you lose sight of it. You don't think that much of it because, again, I was already the captain in Niagara Falls, transitioning to Erie, obviously already that leadership role, so maintaining it. But when you look back on it and seeing it as a first year's franchise or as a new transition franchise within the league, I guess that means a lot more, especially when look back at the success the team had well after the time that I had been there. And just as it continues today, drawing lots of fans, just an excellent franchise, awesome rink. So it was a lot at the time, but not as much as I realized.
You talk about the success that came after, and obviously, I guess, unless you're the Vegas Golden Knights, you don't start with success necessarily right away, but we've had Corey Pecker through this podcast before.
Yeah.
Haven't had Brad Boys yet, but they played together, obviously, in the early glory years for Erie. And did Brad Boys not give credit to you and the rest of your cast of characters and that first year team? You built the foundation for them, Steve.
Yeah, and that's, you know, you talk about humbling and to be mentioned in the same breath as Brad, that's one of the areas that's very humbling. He's a hell of a player, excellent person, just a great guy that I got to know a little bit in the times that we crossed paths down there, going back to watch that team and seeing their success. So I really appreciate that he would say something like that and talk about some of the original Otters in that way.
What did you think going back 20 years later to see the arena in the shape that it was when you got back to it compared to the one you played in?
No, that was wild. It's been a few years now since I've been back, but I had been there after the renovations, and the last game that I was upstairs in the new boxes and wandering around up top, and still packed people right up to the ceiling in there. Loud fans, amazing, a wild crowd in there. And then just to see how much the arena had changed. And heck, even in 96, 97, that was pretty awesome rink to go into. It was amazing. And I think I've heard other people talk about the way that the boards and the glass would sway in there and just how rowdy the fans would get. So to go back to see it even more polished and all the extra bells and whistles was super cool.
Would it be fair to say, Steve, that you never really expected to be an Erie Otter? Obviously, knowing the relocation was going to happen, but I think that when that last year came around for you in the Ontario Hockey League, you had expected to be perhaps somewhere else.
Yeah, and that's just the way that I guess the sport goes. And I finished up my third year in Niagara Falls. Had a fairly decent final year there. We're working through. I'd been in order for the Whalers to maintain my rights the year before after drafting me, they needed to make an offer, and they did. And at the time, my agents walked through and was, no, this wasn't the right thing. And we all agreed that we just move on and go after the full contract at the end of my third year. And it just didn't happen. After the end of the season, we were expecting an offer. We had agents were preparing counter offer, had everything lined up. And just near the deadline, Hartford said, nope, that we weren't going to sign, but please come back as a free agent, which I didn't. Went with the Sounders instead. But I still did not expect to be with in Erie. Figured I'd go play in the AHL someplace. But with the education contract and what Erie was doing, it was the right move at the time to stay with the Otters.
What was that last year in Niagara Falls like for you, irrespective of the fact you thought you'd be going pro the following year, but knowing that it was the last year for that? I mean, I guess I can't say franchise because same franchise, different city, but you were done in Niagara Falls and you knew that.
Yeah. It wasn't, you know, lots of rumors throughout the season, not until really midway, but even to start the year, we knew that we were in tough there. Season ticket holders were way down. We had some drives to pump up that base and do some different things along there. I remember us going door to door, even in Niagara Falls, and trying to drum up support that way as players. And so through the year, we didn't really know what to expect or what would go on. And I guess roller coasters at the end of the season, it came out very quickly that we were done there. Again, I thought I was wrapped up to begin with, so it wasn't going to be that big of an adjustment for me personally. But that's just the way that it went. Mixed emotions. I love Niagara Falls. I still love Niagara Falls. I still get back there as much as I can. Jeff Johnstone was on the team. I talk with him pretty much every day, either text or calls or something like that. So we're heavily connected, and he's still there, so connected back to that city.
If you're going door to door in an effort to try to keep the franchise in the city, I think that speaks to how much you cared for it.
Yeah. And maybe we're just, teens or late teen OHL players. So we're not getting the bigger picture, but yeah, when you talk about it now, that's crazy to think that that's what we needed to do in order to keep the franchise afloat there.
Did that in any way prepare you for the role you sort of played in Erie then, helping establish a new franchise? Because you weren't just the on ice face. And in many respects, Steve, you became the face of the franchise, even off the ice, trying to build a junior hockey fan base in what had been a pro hockey market.
Yeah, it's funny because that summer, when knew that that there might be a chance that I would go to Erie or at least help with the transition, because they had me working in the office, so I was selling advertising actually for the Erie Otters and that first summer that was going through there and working in the front office and doing a lot of we'll call it public relations work with potential sponsors or other people associated with the team. And so I was still living in Niagara Falls. I'd spend about half the week in Niagara Falls and taking a course in university and then going to Erie in the other few days of the week. And working with the front office, so it was pretty cool. But it really did kind of give a little bit more of an aspect of just the player seeing how the business was being run there too.
Did you have to really, in some ways, build a fan base? Because junior hockey, I mean, I love it. You played it. I'm sure you still have fondness for it, but it's a different animal, right? Players are there for 5 years max. They're 16 to 20 years old. They're not grizzled old men, et cetera.
Yeah, very different than the Panthers that were there, right? The East Coast team, a much different cast of characters as opposed to players that were working towards the NHL. And when the franchise moved there, I can't remember. I think there was five or six NHL draft picks already on the team. And then players that were being drafted and going to be up for the draft. So there was a lot of helping people understand that it's a prospects league. And at that time, even so much as players, yes, would transition from the coast to the NHL, it wasn't as much of a stepping stone as it is today. And it was a, a much more of a minor league mentality than compared to now, where it's really even bigger.
Compared to Niagara Falls, as a player, was it all that different? I mean, you find a new billet family, you live with the billet family, et cetera. Like, what was that like transition-wise?
It was very different. I guess Niagara Falls again. Niagara Falls, I lived there year round. In the summer times, that was my new home, and that was the fondness I had there for my billet family, for the friends that I had made, and just the city in general. You have that connection, so it was really a complete new start in Erie, and you've got a much bigger city, you've got a much bigger rink, a much wider potential fan base. So it was a big transition. Then it was a different country, even though you don't think about that as, we had to have proper visas, and we had to go about different avenues that way. So it was a big transition, I think, especially again the size of everything compared to Niagara Falls.
And all of a sudden, travel gets a whole lot more difficult too, doesn't
Oh yeah.
it?
You know what? That's the one thing that was awesome in Niagara Falls. You're pretty close, right? You're close to Kitch. You're close to Guelph. A lot of the road trips weren't so bad. Even swinging across if you had to go east of the GTA, wasn't too bad. And Erie, it's still, you're adding 2 hours to everywhere else that you went automatically. And so we did a lot of road trips differently that year than what we had been used to, a lot more overnight or long swings and things like that. Even think about that. It's talk about digging up memories. Yeah, you're bang on.
Well, I don't know about you, but I've always struggled sleeping on the bus. How did you manage trips? What was your way to pass the time, or could you sleep?
No, you've again at the time you just figure it out, right? So we sleep on the floor, you sleep across two seats, you learn how to contort your bodies in different ways. I know that one of the best moves we ever, it was in Niagara Falls, but we always usually had a late road trip, or sorry, an early season road trip up North Swing, hit North Bay, hit Sudbury, hit Sault Ste. Marie, and then do a straight shot back from Sioux all the way to Niagara Falls. And that was usually around Thanksgiving, it seemed to be. But we had a big piece of plexiglass, of the old rink glass, that we would put between five seats turned around, and then we just made a big bed, and then we could just crash out and sleep there before we had sleeper beds. So that was our trick. We absolutely loved it. It's much more comfortable than sleeping on the floor.
You know what? I didn't even know guys slept on the floor until I took one of my trips. I try very hard to stay in my seat, not get up. I don't want to go to the back of the bus. It's not my place to be. And then the one time I was doing it, we were coming home from probably the Sioux. Anyway, it doesn't matter. But I stepped on a poor kid sleeping on the floor. But I thought, like, where else is he going to stretch out, right?
No, you learn quickly how to climb seats to get to the back of the bus.
I learned way too late, Steve. That's bad, right? It's so bad. I was years into this before I started climbing on the sides of the seats to get there. Terrible. Okay, so that first season in Erie, what was the fan base like? What do you remember of that first game? Like, did people get it? Did they show up? Were they excited? Did they cheer at the right time?
Yeah, I'll say this: the Erie fans knew hockey. That was the one thing that was evident right away. The core base, it was convincing them to go to games. They understood the game. They understood the game very well. And that first home opener, I don't remember exactly if we had a sellout, but it was pretty close. It was a big crowd, and we didn't play that well. I think we lost 3-0 to Detroit at the time, and it wasn't a great showing, to say the least, for a home opener. But there was an excitement, there was an electricity, and then from that one, it kind of built throughout the season. So we had that first home opener, and there's a little bit of momentum. Then the big thing there was always that Thanksgiving, the U.S. Thanksgiving, always had a game there, and that really didn't really understand it, but that was the big draw. That was always the big game in Erie right away. So they made sure to set up the schedule there. We had a sellout, and again, really good rowdy fan base. I think we were one of the first teams in the league that were able to sell beer at games, so that certainly helped to see like a more professional game or more professional arena than we were used to. And then it kept on until late in the season. We had a game against Kitchener that we won on a sellout to in order to get into the playoffs or secure our playoff spot. And so the fans really were more skeptical along the way than they were lacking knowledge. They knew the game, they still do, and they I guess it was nice to see, I guess, a full rank of knowledgeable, excited hockey fans.
That late season game against Kitchener, I believe part of get back to back against them early in that March. And as you said, you secure that playoff berth. But there was also, I think, as I recall, some other reasons for the fans to get kind of excited about that game, despite the outcome. There were some extracurricular activities that night.
Yeah, I think we were up by a handful late in the third period, and one fight, turned into two fights, and it seemed off of every draw there was about seven fights in a row, and it was one after another and after it, and each one the fans just got more excited to the point where they were announcing the penalties. So the PA announcer would ask 5 minutes for, and then 5,500 people yelling fighting. It was exciting. It was enough that each one of us that got tossed, we came down the tunnel and stood at the glass to watch out the rest of the game. So it was a big night for Erie, but I think that was a great night for the team as well.
How did you feel about that aspect of the sport?
The fighting,
Yeah.
it was something that we had to do, or that was part of the game. I never liked hitting, punching someone in the face. I liked even less getting punched in the face. So it was there. I was, well, I wasn't a small guy. Could handle myself. Did okay. I wasn't a goon or a fighter. That wasn't my game. I was told by all my coaches that wanted me on the ice, not in the box. But there was times when it needed to be done, or it came up, or heat of the moment, and yeah, never really enjoyed it, but never really shied away from it either.
Total aside here, but I'm just thinking back on you talking about that Thanksgiving Day always being a big game, a big day game for the Otters. And I've been down to it a couple of times. Can we just call it what it is? Americans do Thanksgiving way better than Canadians. Like, it's not even close, eh?
It's not, and it's funny. We talked about that. My parents, for better than 20 years after I left Erie, would still go down to the Thanksgiving game. Along with my grandparents, they would drive down from. They're still in Oshawa, so they drive 4 hours. They'd go to the game. They would go Black Friday shopping, and they'd head back home. And it was a tradition that they just loved. And it just for my dad to be back at the game and watching a Thanksgiving game and the crowd there. It's part of, for Erie, it's just part of their big weekend. And I think that's so cool. That's so awesome.
To this day in Erie, they call the team's humanitarian award the Steve Nimagon Humanitarian Award. How does that sound to you? How does that make you feel?
That's one of the things I'm most proud of, I think, from my time in Erie. It was surprising when they did that, and they did that the end of the first season there. A lot of that was due to some of the work that I did away from the rink. We were able to do some reading programs with some kids that wouldn't necessarily normally have, I guess, athletes or public figures that would come to their school. And it started out that we were at one of the schools that were doing fundraising, and all the teams do this, where they have players go in the school and meet the kids, and maybe they'll play floor hockey or go around and talk to kids about the importance of balancing whatever they're doing with school and those sorts of thing. And one of the teachers got a little snippy with me at the end of it, and she said, if you really want to do for something for these kids, why don't you come back and read with them? And I said, okay, sure. And she was a little surprised, but Because of the way, because of my age and my university schedule, it was no problem to do that. So I did that the next week, and then turned into a regular thing. And had all the kids get to a game one time and get down the locker. It's one of the my favorite pictures I have from my time in the OHL. All the kids crowd around in the locker, climbing on top of us and stuff like that. It was pretty cool. But yeah, that's still to for it still to be that way is pretty amazing, and a lot of great guys have put their name on that trophy.
How much of that do you still like that attitude and that approach to maybe a hand up for somebody or pitching in here or there in the community? Do you carry with you to this day?
It's important. I'm probably not as active as I should be or would like to be necessarily. I've always liked to do those things kind of quietly in the background anyway. And it's a lot easier now that, no one would know who I was. So it's easy to do that. But we do still some stuff through work and otherwise, but I think it's important. I think that if you have the ability to help other people, whether it be with your time or otherwise, it means a lot.
Do you still keep an eye on the Erie Otters? I mean, they were kind of hard to miss when they had a guy named David playing there, but.
I do. For as much as I can. I think that it's been a while since I got to a game. I actually live in Windsor, so the last game I got to was when they were in the Memorial Cup final here. And that wasn't a great day necessarily, but it was awesome to go to that game. I went with my dad, my grandfather. They both came down. The three of us went off to a game to watch my old team play. And my dad walking around the rink in my old daughter's jersey was pretty cool. So it was a lot of fun. So keep an eye on them, as much as I can in the league. It's amazing where the league is at now. The rinks that these guys have an opportunity to play in, the speed of the game, all that, it's wild.
That is a fantastic story that the three of you could take in that game and dad's wearing your jersey through the arena. Unreal.
It is, and probably most people wouldn't have known what that was either. But it's for the three of us, it was a nice moment.
I'll come back to that in a moment, but I'm curious because a lot of people have said, Steve, that that Memorial Cup, the Otters got jobbed because they had to fight their way all the way through the Western Conference and the OHL final until they meet these very well-rested Windsor Spitfires who got bounced in the first round. Did your former team get robbed in that 17 Memorial Cup?
I gotta say no, because that's just the way the sport goes, and you got to get it done. That's it. It was a great game, but yeah, that Windsor team was on fire that night.
You talk about being at that game with dad, grandpa. It just makes me think of the role that family plays in developing us as humans, period, but specifically in this context as a hockey player. And I mean, there are all those early morning practices. We hear about it all the time, but what role did your family play in helping you on your hockey journey, getting up to the Ontario Hockey League?
No, a huge role, and the biggest role, really. And my parents were great all the way through. Whether it was hockey for myself, whether it was something that my sister was doing at the time or otherwise, they a phenomenal way of supporting us and making sure that we could make our own mistakes, but also there with a support net. And it was when I was drafted to the OHL, I was also big into school, doing well scholastically, and I wasn't sure if I was going to play in the OHL or not, or if I was going to go that route or go through university. And as a 15, 16-year-old, there's a lot of conversations, deep conversations you're having with your parents, and they were very forthright and supportive of making sure that I had all the information I needed and that I was the one making the decision. And I think one of the best things my dad said at the time, and I tell people this different areas, one of the anecdotes I go back to a lot, but said, there's no right or wrong decision here. It's just that you make a decision and you commit to it fully. And whatever one that is, that will be the right decision and go with it. And at that time, I obviously decided to enter the OHL or go through with the draft. but they were instrumental in that, still today supporting me and whatever I need to do, venting from work or talking about family, all those things. They've been very instrumental.
What a great piece of advice. And it worked out really well. Seventh overall, first round to the Niagara Falls Thunder. Would it have mattered to you at that point once you had committed to the decision, Steve? Would it have mattered where you went?
No. Sorry, not entirely true. Yes. At that time, there was probably a few teams that I didn't have an interest in going to, and mostly because, and that's how much things have changed, really. Every team has a solid franchise now. Every team is committed to player education with the league education contracts. And so we didn't even have that then. So had to sign my own education contract on the side. I wanted to be at a team that had a university at least nearby, so when I graduated university or high school, I could still take some university courses while I was playing, things like that. I was hoping deep down that I might slide about five picks and get drafted by the Generals, but that didn't work out that way. And glad it didn't. I was pretty happy in Niagara Falls.
That's quite the attitude for a 15, 16-year-old kid to have, making sure, like you mentioned earlier that you were doing well scholastically, but clearly that was like you were a student athlete or an athlete student. That was very much a part of your identity by the sounds of it.
Yeah, and actually, if you take a look at my old high school yearbooks from before I went to Niagara Falls, I was on the mathlete page too. So that was I was very strong scholastically, and it was important to me that I kept that thing that end of it open.
We talked about the rougher side of the game and your feelings towards it. When I talked about the Niagara Falls Thunder being one of my favorite OHL teams, it just seemed to me, and again, you got to think of growing up, cutting your teeth, watching this game. It seemed to me every time there was a game with Niagara Falls, it was going to be a bit of a battle, and you had some guys that could mix it up. A lot of every team did back then. But that arena too, like, do you just feel like an automatic badass when you walk into that old Niagara Falls arena?
I think you have to. It's
Sure.
small, it's tight. Everything was on, you were on top of everyone, right? So whether the fans were on top of you or as a player, it's smallest rink in the league, I think, at the time from an ice surface wise. So it was always pretty physical. And I mean, I was never the baddest of the badasses on the team by any means. So we had other people that could throw them a little bit better, but it was you take a look at some of the tough guys that went through that team too. It's like, wow, those are some big boys. And maybe the black and red just looked mean, and AC/DC Thunderstruck, it all kind of rolled together.
Yep, exactly. It had all the necessary ingredients, and all of a sudden, you've got yourself that attitude or that people. That's what they expect, right, from this particular team, for example. But getting back to you being there as a first rounder, how did you find the step into the Ontario Hockey League?
It was a tougher adjustment than I expected. I expected to go in there and earn my way onto the team, obviously, but also earn my way and then get lots of opportunities, lots of ice time. And that year was really tough. I wasn't getting ice time to start the year, and it was I understand that's kind of just the way things are. And at the time, though, you got your blinders on, you can't figure it out. And so it took a couple months before I started getting a lot more, regular shifts and being out there and adjusting and still making sure that made the most of the opportunities that I had. And obviously, the team wasn't a very good team that year. And things progressively got worse throughout the season. But by around December, and we had made a couple moves and got more ice time, was playing more regularly, started to see things a little bit better. And then as that progressed and got more opportunities, I blew my knee out. So it was soon as kind of got really motoring along, or felt like I'd kind of made that transition to being there. It was a blown knee and a free play.
What happened?
So of all the places, it was in Oshawa. So we had played an exhibition game to start the year in Oshawa, and I played really well that game as a, and again, you got mixed squads, so it's not all veterans and everyone out there, but I think I had a couple goals and assists, and everyone there, so it was great. And so went back there in January of that season. Lots of friends and family there, but it was just a. I was playing off wing because I had an opportunity to play with a couple of different guys after training. Puck run around the boards in our own end, picked it up. I saw someone coming at me from the other side and braced to absorb the hit and absorb the hit, but everything else went around and my foot stayed in the same spot. So it was bad situation at that point.
What was the recovery like?
That was really tough. I was 17 at the time, and obviously stock was going up for the NHL draft now that I was getting a lot more playing time. And so it was about a month from the injury to surgery, and then surgery was a lot more aggressive, invasive than it is now. Crutches, I think, for 8 weeks or something silly like that afterwards, and then it's all straight into therapy. And so I think it was physically tough, mentally tough too, because at that time too, I actually moved back to Oshawa because of the timing of the school semester, because I could concentrate on getting the recovery time that I needed. Worked with actually with the general's physical therapist at the time. At his clinic, just to get things back to where they needed to be, and then it was fall time before I was even allowed to start skating again.
I've always wondered about that. You mentioned how difficult it can be mentally when you're coming back from an injury like that. That's got to be half the battle too. Like you've been given the clean bill of health from the medical community. That's fine, but mentally, how much does it stick in your mind?
Yeah, and again, you're at the age where you think you're indestructible, right?
Good
You're
point.
17, you're 18, nothing can hurt me. I'm going to get through this, and it's a once I see the strength is there, and then becomes the mental part of it. Can I absorb the same hit? Can I throw myself into someone else? And I probably came back a little bit earlier than I should have. Probably mostly fully healed, but maybe not quite. And again, we're not as smart than as we are now in terms of how we kind of build players up in terms of how much ice time they get, or in terms of practice or game ready recovery. But it was certainly figuring out whether what I can and can't do, and when I couldn't do it, take a step back, two step forwards, two more forward, two more back, until I figure out exactly where. And it was probably a good, back to playing another month or two before I really got back into the groove of being the player that I wanted to be.
How's the knee doing today?
Good enough. Good enough. Yeah. Ironically enough, I don't really skate much anymore. No reason for it. I just about 10 years ago, I moved from where I was living to where I am now, and just never had the group to skate with down here. So it kind of got put aside, and it's not a it's not 100%, but it's good enough to get around the golf course and everything else I want to do.
Yeah, but that's all that matters, right? Getting around the
Yeah.
golf course, some of the other things for sure. You mentioned, Steve, that the first year in the O that wasn't the best team, you struggled, missed the playoffs. The next two, you're coming back from your injury, that second one, and you make the playoffs both those next two seasons, both times against those darn Owen Sound Platers. They get you once, you get them once. What was playoff hockey like for you in the O?
Playoff hockey was a lot of fun. Loved it. Like to this day, that the smell of hockey in the springtime, and you'll know it because you get on the bus and that time of year, but there's just something about it. And at that time, obviously, we're pretty excited. We're young and going back and forth there. My first year wasn't that was an awful playoff for me personally. I separated my shoulder in the second game of a I think a 6-game series. So those next four were pretty tough. I remember getting still playing, getting loose on a breakaway. I couldn't shoot, so my left arm was kind of just with my right arm trying to flip it on net. Sort of thing, but again, you play through those things at the time, and it's just again just the excitement, the feel of it, working towards the goal of winning or eliminating a team. It just it's different than just one-off games. And then that second season against Owen Sound, or sorry, that second playoff the next year, my third year against Owen Sound, that was a lot of fun because we were firing all cylinders and the team was humming. It was exciting hockey.
And you get the chance to advance that time too, which
Yeah.
is, right, the ultimate feeling for sure.
Yeah, big difference. And that was and we had a good series. So to feel that and win, that there isn't too many feelings like it in terms of advancing in the playoffs and working one step closer to that goal.
What was your least favorite building to play in?
I knew this question was coming. I've heard, and it's going to be the one that everyone else says. It was Windsor,
Of course it
and
was.
I think I said this. I live in Windsor now. I actually work in Michigan, so I cross the border pretty much every day, and I drive by that rink almost every single day still. And it is, it was always the worst place to play because the fans were just, they were something else. And it's that tunnel that you walked, or kind of sort of tunnel from the dressing room onto the ice, and people are grabbing your stick and throwing coins at you and spitting at you. And it was just it was not a lot of fun. Although I loved coming to Windsor, just from a road trip perspective, it was one that we usually hit up London and Windsor and then headed back. So it was usually a pretty good road trip.
Yeah, I don't know what it was about that barn. Did you ever get any, well, I know what it was about that barn, but did you ever get any sense that when the fans in Erie were like really into it, maybe you had a little bit of that, short of, I didn't hear anybody throwing coins
Oh
there, but the
no.
glass bangers and all that stuff?
No, I don't think so. I think Erie were perfect angels the entire time. There was just something mean. There was just something mean about the Windsor fans at that time. And when I was there for the Mem Cup, there it was a completely different feel. There was something about that rink in general where everyone was in gray, maybe, and it was almost kind of dreary, and everyone was just it was they were mean fans. They would yell, and maybe the Erie fans might have got that way a little bit at times, but for sure when you see them rocking the glass in Erie, that was a lot of fun.
It was. And I remember, and I'm not saying anything ill about fans in Erie because I love them too, but not long after you were gone, Steve, they started doing Buck a Beer Night. And you mentioned earlier they might have been the first arena to be able to sell beer, but we were there for a couple of those games, and guys were coming back like with armloads of their Buck a Beers, right? So that's okay. You can have a little fun while you're out for the night. Why not?
Might as well. I did not even know they had done that. That's pretty wild.
Shockingly, it didn't last all that long, but
Yeah, go figure.
I mentioned at the outset that not only did I love the Flyers as a Niagara Falls as a franchise, but or the Thunder and the Flyers and the other teams that went through there, but also the team that you got drafted by in the National Hockey League. I'm a Leafs fan through and through, but my first NHL game at Maple Leaf Gardens was against none other than the Hartford Whalers. What did you think? What was going through your mind when they picked you in the 11th round?
Yeah, it's funny. First, I didn't expect to get drafted. That was the thing. So I was obviously, like I said, I hurt myself a little while and before and was in recovery and didn't expect to be drafted that year. Was rated decently before the injury or as I got injured, and then even though it went through a lot of the interviews and such, given the timing, just didn't expect it to happen. So it's a little surprise. I actually didn't find out till the reporter from Niagara Falls called my house. So again, pre-internet, right? So I'd gotten home. I was actually working that day, and got home, and Rob called me and had, said, "So what do you think about the draft?" And a couple of teammates were first round picks, and I was surprised that he wanted comments on that. And then he's like, "No, you got drafted by the Whalers." I'm like, "Oh, hey, mom and dad, guess what?" It was kind of a. And then shortly thereafter, someone from the team called me. I think I hung up the phone, and they called immediately afterwards. But it was obviously pretty exciting. It was more of a, okay, that's the next step. Next step is to, find a way to sign and move on. But I always kind of thought they were great uniforms, cool. There's something cool about the Whalers, so I was excited to be drafted by them. And you still see the Whalers hats kind of floating around in different areas, or shirts and jerseys and stuff like that. So it was an exciting time. Unfortunate that it wasn't more than a few years later that it moved, but it was exciting at the time.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. It's a classic logo, a classic jersey. Every time you see it, when you look back on that, because it didn't work out perhaps the way you would have thought at the time, any regret?
No, not at all. And I'm a pretty fortunate guy. I've got a great job. I've got a university degree. I've got great friends from hockey. I've got great connections through hockey. I've got awesome memories. I got to live in Europe. All these sorts of things. So the fact that I didn't make the NHL, that at the time was disappointing, and obviously took some time to get a good perspective, but zero regrets. And I'm a fortunate person. I'm really lucky to be where I am today.
That university degree at St. FX, you could do a whole lot worse than that, my friend.
Yeah, and that was the again, but the OHL, it gave me that opportunity, right? And again, the education packages are different than they were then, but that was one of the big reasons why I was able to go to X at the time so quickly, was because I had my school package, and then the team out there was awesome, and the experience.
How'd you like the hockey in, I don't know what they were calling it then, but U Sports today?
It was an adjustment because of the short schedule, right?
Right.
28 game season, so one or two games a week, and a shorter season, so a longer practice season. So practices were intense, and that was one adjustment. I loved the hockey. It was great that, again, after the adjustment of no fighting, or essentially, no. So it was a little transition from there. That was the first time I had played without the red line. So that was a faster game at times. But just the intensity that every game mattered was pretty wild. And you, because of that, every practice mattered. And Danny Flynn, who's the coach there, had us very well prepared, and practices were intense. So it was once the transition was there, it was fantastic hockey, and the skill level was much higher than anyone realized at the time.
We've got Danny's son Brad as an assistant coach in Kitchener right now. Are there any stories about his dad I should remind him of?
Oh gosh, they can tell on the podcast? No. One, that's awesome. Well, send him my best. It
I
was
will.
great. Glad to hear that. That's where he's landed, and if he's got his dad's skill set, then he's going to be a hell of an addition there. Danny is a phenomenal coach, a phenomenal hockey person.
Yeah, I've heard nothing but great things about him over the years on this podcast. He's scouting with Columbus. We still see him around the rink on a regular basis. And I think this game is just better with a guy of Danny's caliber in it, quite frankly.
Oh, absolutely. I have yet to meet anyone, and I've met a lot of really smart hockey people, anyone as in tune with the game as Danny was, and just his ability to see what it is to dissect the game and then communicate that back to people. It's just excellent. He's the game's better because he's in it.
I was just talking to somebody on the podcast recently with a very similar kind of trajectory as yours. Got the education package, went to Europe, and you've made it very clear that the education package was something that was really important to you. What advice would you give to a player coming into the Ontario Hockey League today when it comes to maybe the importance around that scholastic package?
I think it's about being a well-rounded person, right? And not taking a myopic view of any one thing, whether it be hockey, whether it be school, whether it be something else that you're passionate about. The packages they have now, and you'd know better than I would, but I believe they have a grace period now from the end of their final year to when they need to use it. At the time, for us, for those of us that had school packages, we couldn't play one professional game. If you signed a professional contract, the moment you do that, your package is null and void. So it transition is a lot quicker. So I think it's just take the opportunity, slow down, enjoy the moment, but take the opportunity.
One thing that I've learned for certain about you today, Stephen, you were talking about how fortunate you feel with good job, still in touch with people you played the game with, those networks, those connections, et cetera. But somewhere along the line, you became a hell of a chef. When did Steve Nimagon become such a foodie? Come on.
Oh, you've been checking my social media for that one. Yeah. I don't know. I think probably a little bit when I was in school, but mostly probably when I played in Europe, played with lived with two other or two other Canadian players, and I was the cook in the house, and then that became my new thing once I stopped playing. That's what I love to do. That's how I unwind.
I think it's awesome. So I don't know if a foodie such as you would slum it with us Windsor pizza loving guys, but for me,
Oh.
it's the best stuff going.
So I live about a 3-minute walk from one of the top spots here in Windsor is Antonino's,
That's my spot.
and
That's my
okay.
spot.
So yeah, I'm walking distance to Antonino's, and yeah, they put up a good pizza. Now, I can't get behind the whole canned mushrooms thing about Windsor, but I'll give them the shredded pepperoni and the cornmeal crust. So those are the two wins. But Windsor pizza, it's a cult. Don't get too wound up on it.
Well, that's the th and when I lay claim to Antonino's as my spot, there are others who will pick, there's a two or three other really popular places, but
No, for sure.
well, yeah, the first time I'm actually relatively new to the Windsor pizza scene, and we actually picked one up after a game one night, and I was like, I'm not gonna lie, Steve, I dummied pretty much the entire box on my drive home. So there you go.
That's an acceptable behavior. I do the same thing.
Listen, it's great to get some time with you on this podcast. The one of the original Erie Otters and the first captain of the team, the Steve Nimagon Humanitarian Award carries on, and you got it all started. Thanks so much for joining us.
No, I really appreciate being here. And again, it's humbling given the guests that you have had on here. So it's been a lot of fun.